Everybody hear that? All right, recording is in progress. Hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming out for tonight, August 17, 2022's Triangle Skeptics in the Virtual Pub meeting. I'm Jeff Gelbach. I'm your tour guide and executive director of Triangle Skeptics, whatever that means. I see a lot of new faces. I see a lot of familiar faces, and I'm thrilled at this observation. Just wanted to open with a few remarks. Tonight, we are going to hear Eric Harris talk about the nature of perception and reality. It's not going to be quite that broad, okay. but I do want to say, especially for the new faces here, just so that you don't have a rude surprise on your hands, we are skeptics in the mold of Carl Sagan and James Randi. We are not metaphysicists. We are people who demand extreme evidence when extreme claims are made. That's the kind of skeptics that we are. That said, I want to remind everybody, please do check your biases at the door, which means you're unable to leave them behind, but know what they are. And respect your fellow humans. So we all have our own outlooks here. And with that, I'd like to introduce tonight's speaker, Triangle Skeptics' very own Eric Harris. Eric is a neuroscientist by trade and a longtime skeptic and science enthusiast. And most importantly, tonight's speaker. Eric is going to give us a fascinating presentation on the topic. I've hyped it too much. It's not going to be fascinating. It's just going to be fine. No, it's going to be great. Presentation on visual illusions. I'd like to say, please, if you have questions about the illusion that you're seeing on the presentation in that moment, feel free to interject with those. If you have more overarching general questions, please save those for the Q&A portion of the talk at the end. Just jot them down so you don't forget them. If you're like me, you will forget them if you don't jot them down. I think I've said all the things that I need to say. I've probably left some things out of your introduction, but I see that you have an intro slide. So I'm going to mute myself now and you will unmute and we will proceed.
In theory, I just unmuted, did I?
You're good.
I hear no one else, but that could be because they've all muted.
I hope they've all muted.
Oh, okay. Well, then—
We do hear you.
Great, thank you for that. I'm going to let Jeff sort of be the traffic cop here, and then I'm only going to be looking at my screen and I guess my camera so that if I make any appropriate, well, if I may make some faces in relation to what's going on in the talk, most of them unintentional probably. Anyway, let's get started. So let's just get started.
Let's do it.
But first, a bit about the presenter. So yes, I'm a lifelong scientist. I showed this slide because this is a book that I got when I was, I believe, 6 years old, 6 and a half, that really crystallized what I wanted to do the rest of my life, because it explained stuff. And it didn't just have hand wave explained. It had explanations with evidence, either diagrams or data or graphs or something in a way that was persuasive to me. And the other reason I think this is relevant to tonight's talk is, while reading this book, I remember seeing the, I guess it's the Niels Bohr model of the atom, you know, where there's a little tiny nucleus and then there's an electron way the heck out here somewhere. And I was sitting there thinking, wow, that's really cool. And I was tapping my finger, thinking about this model, you know, where there's a little dense nucleus, electron way out here. And I was thinking, oh, so it's all mostly space. And I thought, no, wait a minute, if it's mostly space, why doesn't my finger go through the table? And in that moment, that kind of was the burgeoning of my becoming a evidence-based skeptic, where there's no denying that my finger wasn't going through the table. It didn't make sense, and yet there it was, you know, that reality can be counterintuitive, and there was something clearly that I did not know. So rather than going, well, that's just, no, my finger does go through the table, I reject this model, I realized I needed to investigate further. All right. Very, very briefly, you know, this is sort of my background. Was my professional career was mostly in pharma. Again, just sort of my training's in neuroscience. And I only put this up here to illustrate that I did the R side, you know, of R&D, you know, finding molecules. And Cato Research is a contract research organization that does a lot of interactions with the FDA. And I mention that only because it turns out the FDA is full of a lot of really good skeptics. they're very good at answering questions to clarify evidence, you know, exactly what was measured, how was it measured, how was it analyzed, does that really relate to the target indication? I learned a lot from the much maligned FDA. Again, not a fan of everybody there, but a big fan of a lot of the scientists. And I think that contributed to my honing some of my skeptical inquiry skills. Now I am retired, happily so. This is now my new skeptical, my new investigative tool, I should say. I got to say, at the risk of sounding sexist, every boy deserves a tractor. Oh my God. Anyway. So why talk about visual illusions at a skeptics meeting? Well, but first, some definition of terms. So an illusion is a percept, something that's in our mind, that differs from objective reality. You know, some obvious examples that we can all experience, or I guess experience if you've been in space, the Earth certainly appears flat. You know, if you go to Oklahoma or Kansas or somewhere, sure looks flat, ball, put a ball on the highway, didn't roll anywhere. but you can demonstrate that that's not true by then having someone drive away and you see that car disappear over the horizon and they will say, no, I didn't go up or down. Or stars rotate around the Earth. You know, it certainly looks that way, but then you can get a pendulum and demonstrate that in fact the Earth is rotating, not the stars. Visual illusions in particular, and by that I don't mean optical illusions. Optical illusions result from effects, physical effects on beams of light. And here's some examples. A rainbow. It sure looks as if there are big arcs of color in the sky, but as we all know, that's just a diffraction of light. Or if you have a glass handy and a straw, you can do this one for yourself. It looks as if that straw has changed in shape and size and direction, but it's just light being bent by the glass and the water. Or a mirage. You know, it sure looks as if there's water over there, but there isn't. It's just the sky being reflected by the fact that the ground is so hot, diffracting the light. So, but it's something to why talk about visual illusions, because there are all kinds of illusions. There are auditory illusions, tactile illusions, body image illusions. But to my mind, visual illusions demonstrate undeniably. You can put your finger on them. You can see them. You can talk about them, you can have an absolutely shared experience with someone. They demonstrate undeniably how our percepts can differ from objective reality. And ironically, they challenge the truth of, I saw it with my own eyes, as we'll see later on. So going back to that first slide and the graphic on the announcement, those lines, are they parallel? I mean, they certainly don't look parallel distance to me. So I'm going to bring in a little red square, and I promise there are no tricks in here. And you tell me. So there, you know, the red square is that distance from the line here, same distance there, same thing here and here. These lines are all horizontal, they're all parallel, even with that square there, it's hard to not see that. It's hard to see that. It's hard not to see the illusion. there probably are some excellent scientific explanations for why that particular pattern causes them to look bent. I don't have that. If anyone does, send me a link. I'd love to know. But it's something to do with the fact that we have visual systems, our eyes and our brains. We don't have cameras. and so our visual system helps us in some ways, but it has its limitations like anything. So here's another one of my favorite visual illusions. This spiral that you see below, is it actually a spiral? You know, try to follow those lines around and you might see that in fact, no. So I just put a big circle, you know, around and inside two of those lines, and you can tell that in fact, those are all circles. But even with that black circle there, I have a hard time not seeing a spiral. It's because I have a normal functioning human visual system that can somehow be tricked by the staggering of those lines. here's another one. Look at this. You see a grid And if you look straight in the middle of it, you see white dot in the center and you see black dots off to the side. Now go look at those black dots and they're gone. And now they're the white dot there, they're black dots off the side. Now go to the side again. Anyway, I hope everyone can see this, that wherever you look, it looks white. In the periphery, it's black. And again, this is part of how our brains are made. They help us detect edges, but in having the kind of edge inhibit and so on, they can create this illusion of there being black dots where there's nothing at that intersection. And again, if somebody doesn't see one of these, actually, please do raise your hand or let Jeff know, because I'm fascinated with, do all illusions work for all people? I suspect not, because we all different. So anyway.
Eric?
Yes, please.
Go back to the previous one.
Okay. Yep.
It seems like if I stare hard at the center dot, I don't see any other dots.
Excellent.
Do you get that?
Yes. And I have another example of that. And I'll talk about why that happens a little bit. Okay. But thank you. Thank you for bringing that up. Yes. Good. Okay. So here's a picture, you know, a little mini chessboard with a green cylinder on it. Which is a darker shade of gray, square A or square B? Now, you know, we don't have to do a show of hands, you know, but other than, does anyone here think that square B is darker than A? I'm going to assume no. Does anyone here see that A and B are the same shade of gray? I'm going to assume no. So I've created a mask, and just forgive the ugly color, but it's what I thought worked best. I'm going to slide that over to block what's around squares A and B, and I promise there is absolutely no trickery involved. Okay, here we go. So Jeff's head just snapped back, exactly the intended effect.
And I've seen this.
And I'm going to back that up again. And it's one more time, but this time, just so stare like just like at this corner of B. Just keep your eyes there. You know, like that's where your eyes are, but you're kind of paying attention to the color of B. Okay, so it looks lighter than A, right? But look in that corner of B. Yeah, somehow that makes me see that transition of when it's suddenly they become the same color all over again. And of course, the reason is that we see differences that fit our expected visual setting, but not really reality. Now, obviously, if this was a picture, it would not necessarily be the same gray, but we see that difference because it fits what we expect, which is one is in shadow, one is not. Go ahead, someone was going to say something?
Yeah, I was going to say it makes sense. The purpose of our visual system is not to give us a bitmap of what's out there. The purpose is to tell us what the color is. So if something is in a shadow, you would know it was lighter if the shadow wasn't there. So for the purposes of dealing with reality, you'd like to think that B is a light thing and A is a dark thing, because and so your mind does that change, and you know, because your brain isn't built to detect the exact shade of a picture, it's to detect what the actual object looks like. You know what I'm saying?
Yes, I think I have a convert. Yes, no, exactly. Our brains, if not their purpose, their evolutionary advantage is in interpreting the world in with some predictive utility. Yeah. You probably said it better than I did. I just had to use the polysyllabic term.
There's also a question from Beth in the chat.
There's a question from Beth. I don't, can you read the question for? Oh, sorry.
If you can read that.
Would this illusion be apparent to someone that doesn't go? What an excellent question. Way. Similarly, and just a little digression, there were some studies done some time ago, and just, you know, forgive you know, the people doing the studies, for it involved animals. They had some kittens whose visual system is pretty well mapped out and studied, and they raised some of them entirely in the dark, you know, or with their eyes sewn shut. I apologize for that detail, but that was the case. and then studied what they could see when they grew up. So, you know, their visual systems mature and then are hardwired by a certain age. Or they would do the same thing and raise kittens in an environment where all they saw was vertical lines or all they saw was horizontal lines. And what was interesting is the kittens who'd had no visual experience basically just could not really see. You know, they couldn't hardly recognize anything. Most interesting is, for your point, the kittens who were raised so that they only ever saw horizontal lines during their developmental period could not see the leg of a table. They would walk into it. Or the ones who were raised with only vertical would walk off the edge of the table because they couldn't see the horizontal line. Or it couldn't see, meaning did not grok it, whatever you want to call it. So to make a short answer, very long, yes, previous experience does matter. And I think I totally agree. I think it's a really good point regarding this visual illusion. I hope that answers your question. So you look here and you can see that gray kind of horizontal line in the middle, you know, gets lighter, it gets darker as it gets near those cylinders. You know what's coming. So here's another mask, and I promise no trickery. Okay, it's just a solid gray line. Let's just undo that. I dare you to see that as a solid gray line, again, in your central vision. Now, interestingly, with a lot of these, if you look to the side, the illusion goes away. This is not one that goes away for me, like as was mentioned about the black dots. Let's do that one more time. Yeah, I know. I love this. Jeff is nodding. which red bar is longer? Taller, if you will. Well, obviously the one on the right, but you know what's coming. No, they're exactly the same length. And this, then, Beth, for your question, is another good example of how those look like converging lines converging in the distance. That looks sort of like a wall or a hallway, half of a hallway. To a child or somebody who's never lived in houses, maybe this would not work for them. They might see it as, I don't know, just a bunch of lines.
Or someone who's not drawn three-dimensional shapes for purposes of geometry homework.
Yes, that sounded like a little bit of self-revelatory history there. I'm not sure. I totally agree. And, you know, which makes the point that even though we all have brains that can grow similarly, environment matters. It's another sort of aspect of context, as it were. Our brains can perceive converging lines as representing distance, even though they're not actually receding. So to me, and about you, it looks as if the Leaning Tower of Pisa on the right is leaning a little further to the right than the other one. Jeff is nodding. I'm not sure if anyone else sees that. Sure looks like that to me, you know, in these two different pictures. But you know what's coming. It's the same picture. It's exactly the same picture side by side. And I didn't do an animation of that, but I promise you. And it's just, you know, because that somehow emphasizes the lean, or the slight difference in how much sky there is, I don't really know. But this to me is a very interesting illusion. It's the same picture. And again, maybe this is a case of how our brains make sense of what we see. On the right is a little picture of the Petrona Towers, really, in Dubai, somewhere, yes. Saudi Arabia, I can't remember. And in this case, you know, those do appear to converge, those two towers. If you look at the distance at the bottom or the distance at the top. And I guess that's what we expect with the two pictures on the left. We expect they should converge if they're two identical, if they're towers next to each other, but they don't converge because it's just the same picture. So again, expectation. Uh-oh, Jeff's looking up something. He's looking up Petronas Towers. We are predictable, aren't we? Those are just, you know, static pictures and how we interpret them. If I click on this, I sure hope this works. Oh, good. So just look at those blue bars that are moving, and you can see that the northeast and southwest pair are moving separately from the northwest southeast pair. obviously. Except, of course, that they're not. So I'll make them visible again. And then make it visible. Now, here's an interesting one, to me at least. If I look off to the side, look up like to the right-hand part of the display, and just out of the corner of my eye, they all seem to move together. Mm-hmm. So, you know, our central vision is wired a little differently from our peripheral vision. You know, we detect different things. You tend to want to detect motion accurately on the side, and you want detail and context in the center. I mean, that's an oversimplification, but I think that tends to be the case for a lot of these illusions. So just one more time. Yeah. And you see it in the upper right-hand corner. And I have a link to this, the site from which this illusion comes. There are a number of them. All right, now see, I think if I go back over here, we should get back to the presentation. Good. Oh, okay. So our peripheral vision can seem more accurate than our central vision, as we saw in that previous motion thing. But in this case, what I want you to do is just stare at the cross or just stare at the blob, like the, let's say, the upper right-hand yellow blob. Just stare at it. Do not move your eyes. Just stare at it. Don't look anywhere else. And all the other blobs go away. Don't move your eyes. Now move your eyes. They come back. Is anyone not getting that? I like to stare at the yellow one, and like this one right here. And that works really well for me. Everybody's gone but that guy. Or girl, sorry. Anyway, the idea here is that we adapt to static inputs, especially in our periphery that's kind of there to detect motion and change. And so we can become blind to stationary things of colors, especially in our peripheral vision. So in some cases, peripheral vision seems more accurate, some cases not, it depends. You still struggling with that one, Jeff? Oh, the chat is probably ruining it for you. Oh, there's something in the chat. Or is the chat disrupting it for you?
Oh, it's not disrupting it at all.
Oh, but there is something.
Just that you might want to take a peek.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yeah, I did for the slow response. Yes, absolutely. It also depends upon when they become blind. If somebody has developed into their teenagehood with normal vision and then loses sight and then gains it back, they tend to have more normal vision, but it depends on how much you developed beforehand. The good point. Thank you for bringing that up.
So I don't know how audible I am on air. I don't want to unmute because I don't want to get crossed on, but I have a couple of hardware defects that seem to make this one not work quite the way for me that it does for others.
Okay.
I think the one that's in play on this illusion is that I have Deuter anomaly.
Oh,
a color vision deficiency.
Oh, that's fascinating. So I wouldn't have thought that would make a difference, but it does.
Certain greens and yellows especially.
Oh, that's cool.
So if I stare at one of the top right one, which to me looks green or yellow.
Oh my gosh. Oh.
The south one doesn't quite go away fully.
Oh, that's fascinating. I don't know if everybody got that, but Jeff's color vision is different from quote unquote normal, let's just say statistically more common. And for him, this illusion does not work. I have another couple of color illusions. I can't wait to hear you weigh in on them.
I have to say that they don't totally disappear for me. It feels like they get lighter, but.
Right. You got to really stare.
I'm not concentrating enough, you know.
Yeah, that's right. Too much caffeine for you.
The distance that it is, like if I hold the screen closer to my face versus farther away, if you move your screen closer to your face, it becomes more apparent.
Yeah. I must be really simple because to me that works at any distance. But yeah, thank you for pointing that out. Again, it's how we're wired. It's how steady our eyes are. It's our color vision.
It depends on whether both your eyes converge to, right? So it's 85% of the population, converges, and the 15% doesn't converge. So I know I'm in the 15%. So if when your two eyes don't converge, that means you're constantly rotating between one eye to the other.
Yeah.
So in that case, this illusion doesn't really work out like.
What if you cover? What if you cover one eye?
No, this is it's interesting. No,
then work for
yeah,
you?
I think if you cover one eye, it works a little better, but it still doesn't work completely. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's fascinating, and of course, I'm so glad you had these comments because part of the, you know, being I think an appropriate skeptic or a scientific skeptic or whatever we call ourselves is realizing that again we all different. We have all different perspectives. Biases that we need to check at the door, as you said. But thank you for bringing that up. I did not realize that that common an occurrence to have non-convergence. Interesting. Okay. so, you know the answer to this question. Are the X's, you know, where the bars cross? So is this thing the same color as that thing? Asks Eric with a wink. So what I'm going to do, what I've done, and again, I swear there's no trickery. I'm not clever enough with IT. You guys now know that. I'm going to take, I like sort of Photoshop or cut or whatever the right word is, this thing, and I'm going to slide it over to there, okay, to compare them. Okay, here we go. Okay, let's do that again. Now, what you might notice, what this happens for me, is right about here, it changes color. Now, I'm sorry, it appears to change color. It is not a different color. So and it's like, I almost don't believe this. You know, it's like, come on, I'm looking, I can tell right there, they're the same. And unfortunately, I can't really do this under my periphery. I don't have enough resolution to really see that particular bit. But you know, again, context can really matter, especially when it comes to colors, especially if we have are differently color enabled, I guess, or whatever that word is. Anyone want to see that one again, or should I move on? All right, we'll move on. We're good. Oopsie, sorry, we had to do it one more time. So another color one, let me click on this. What I want you to do is just stare at the X, just fixate on the X, and pretty soon some of you will see a light green blob moving around the circle. And yeah. Soon after that, the pink blobs may start to disappear. Is anyone not seeing green?
The green.
You got it?
I got the green, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, the disappear is hard. It's so hard to fixate because I want to go look at that green dot.
If I jiggle my laptop like the slightest, the greens disappear. But if I hold it very still, the greens appear.
And this is a case of, again, it's sort of an adaptation. You know, those your pink seeing brain parts are tired of seeing pink. And so when the pink goes away, you see like the reverse of pink, which is that lilac, let's call it lilac. I don't know if that's actually a lilac color. I see it as a pale green.
When I blink, the green disappears.
Absolutely. Then you reset, right. Yeah, because you've sort of allowed all those receptors to kind of desaturate, as it were. Yeah, I love this. And it's funny, I don't know, again, we'll get to talk about this more later, but in like everyday life, I'm constantly seeing things out of the corner of my eye that aren't there. You know, piece of paper, blowing in the wind, no, there was nothing there, it was a shadow, or it was a light, or it was a cat, you know, or of course, probably no cats can turn into pieces of paper, they're kind of magical. Anyway, so just kind of look around this, especially don't just look in one spot, kind of move your eyes back and forth across it. And I wonder, does anyone not see that image as sort of waving? Does anyone see it as not wave or not see the wavy motion? Jeff, you got that one?
I got it.
Interesting. Yeah. And yet, you know, again, you can put your finger on it and show that nothing's moving. And it's just we can see movement where there is none. I don't have a full explanation for this one either, why that particular pattern does it. What's also interesting to me is when I see that as a series of troughs, that's what I see first. I can then flip it and make those hanging billows, as it were. But of course, there is no three-dimensionality there. Any more chat? Okay, so we're gonna go back to that website again. What you're gonna do, what I want you to do is to look at the red dot and figure out which way the thing, the little satellites around it are moving, meaning are they moving, you'll see what I mean. And then look at the yellow dot to confirm that. And then look at the, you'll see. So look at the red dot, and I see the satellites is going counterclockwise around the red dot. And at the corner of my eye, without looking, I see the black dots going clockwise around the yellow dot. But if I look at the yellow dot, I see the reverse. And so here's a really perhaps the best example of how your central vision is different from your peripheral vision. Because where you're looking centrally, we tend to see counterclockwise, and the periphery sees clockwise.
I think the counterclockwise is fairly objectively real. But it's the peripheral that for some reason sees the odd thing.
I think you're right. Yes. Yeah. And I guess I can put my finger and follow one of the dots.
Yeah.
Sure looks like counterclockwise. If I go over here, sure. Yeah, I totally agree. But again, I saw with my own eyes the Ferris wheel was going the wrong way. Well,
I'd like to point out that if we were in the 1600s, you'd be burned at the stake for being a witch right now.
One of the highest compliments I've ever got. Yeah. Well, I mean, if I had a laptop in the 16th century, yeah, I'd be. I don't know if I'd be.
You'd be the Pope if you had a laptop in 1600. So.
But I'd have no place to plug it in.
No Wi-Fi.
That's right. Yeah.
Or you'd be really smart for like 2 hours.
Hey, I sense a movie in there. I sense a movie plot. All right, let's go back here. And of course, this is kind of a classic. So forget, we see colors that aren't there, the movement that's not there. We see that the things that our brains are best at is seeing patterns. And I guess everybody sees the white triangle, right? Undeniable, except for one thing. There is no white triangle. There is no white triangle. There is no man behind the curtain. No. I just love this. And it's just undeniable. Again, mostly for central vision. It's kind of in peripheral for me, but mostly central. If I look there, I just cannot help but I just want to put a triangle there to make it quote unquote fit. And there's all kinds of patterns we're really good at seeing, especially with faces. And so, yeah. That crazy dryer is driving me. loudmouth Texas fan. Yeah. Oh, and again, if anyone does not see or easily see a face in one of these, let me know. Because there's something called prosopagnosia, where people don't recognize faces very well. So there is actually a part of our brain that is dedicated to faces. This is why we see faces so well. If we had a part dedicated to seeing airplanes, and I guess maybe we'd see airplanes in here, I don't know. And I have
said a lot of. Yeah.
Yes, go ahead. Whoever, I'm sorry, there are two people. Go ahead, one of you.
No, so I actually attended a lecture a long time ago on architecture as undergrad, and they said that if you look at the traditional Greek and Roman architecture, and this is in some of the older Chinese architecture as well, they actually build the building, especially the facade of the building, like a face. The reverse is true as well. It's actually the classic architecture because it's the most pleasing to our eyes.
Oh, that makes perfect sense. Yeah, because we are social creatures. We seek out
we're looking for face every time we were so if you look at the classic pantheon, they all have, you can all draw a line around and see a face.
That's great. I'll have to look for some other examples besides just the barn, but being a a hobby farmer, and this is, of course, I have to go there.
Look at car bumpers.
Say it again.
Look at car bumpers. Like once you realize the headlights look.
Oh yeah, car. Absolutely.
Cars yeah, if you look at the bumper, it looks like a face.
Yeah.
Like, well, face, and then the.
I just have to comment. The couch, I absolutely love. The one I just put up, the one on the top right, because you'd think that who would want to buy that unless you're really angry at people and like, I don't know. Jeff was pointing at the wall. Yes, there's that one. Now, what's interesting to me is if you look at those faces, although they're only slightly different, but the ones on the left, the gray ones look angry, the white ones look surprised. Mm. Now, to me, what's interesting is not that they're different, because they are actually slightly different in an actual structure, but that we see emotions in these things. Mm. You know, it's just undeniable. This guy's angry.
Above the eye tend to be darker. Yeah.
Well, yeah, and I think how they're constructed, if you look in the middle, yeah. It looks like they're slightly different. But I mean, I just can't not see anger there. I cannot make that thing look happy or neutral. It's an angry electrical socket.
There's actual lines on it. So if you look at the top where the two prongs go into,
yep.
Got like a V shape, and one is
yes.
pointed outward, the other one's pointed inward.
Oh yes, absolutely. No, I think they are actually different. But to me, yeah. the point is that it's so easy to see, because we're humans and we read faces, unless you know, or maybe you're autistic or something, or have prosopagnosia, we read faces, we read into faces. It's a very important survival skill. And so it evolved.
A lot of butterflies and animals like that, they'll evolve like these spots on their back that make predators think they're looking at a pair of eyes.
Yes,
rather than looking at the wings of an animal.
Yes, there's something called the death mask butterfly, death mask moth, something where the top of it looks like a human sort of skull. Very fascinating. This flower is one of my favorite. I mean, come on. There's a skeleton there, you know?
About that is I can't see animals in the wild necessarily being scared by a human skull, but humans are pretty psyched out by that. But it doesn't seem like it would evolve to upset humans.
Right, yeah, I, this is way beyond my area of expertise or even this discussion, but I make up in my mind that either the death's head moth is has nothing, it's just a random coincidence, yeah. Or maybe was cultivated by humans because they thought it had mystical powers, and so that's why there's
funny.
Or maybe was, who knows, I don't know, and I shouldn't go any further. I think I have just one more. Oh yeah. I can't think, this is from the Hubble telescope. You know, it's a happy universe out there, people. Let's remember that and take it home.
Eric, I can't help but wonder if those angry outlets would look angry to people who did not grow up with like emojis and, you know, colon dash parentheses for a smiley face. Do you think?
That's a very interesting question. I mean
we
to me,
can't ask scenes... anybody that was not alive for that, but.
Well, I grew up without emojis.
Yeah, I didn't have emojis until, you know, 20 years ago. I'm 77.
But you grew up with still animated comic books.
I grew up with cartoons, yeah. I guess we have to go to somebody in a non-graphic culture. And I'm sure those exist, you know, somewhere, and see what they see. That's a very interesting question.
I could have easily learned it since I've seen emojis, since I have seen them for quite a while now. And I don't know that I ever noticed that on a wall switch, you know, 20 years ago. Maybe it's something I've learned.
And I also say that per your point about the actual shape of it, looking at the wall switches that are on the wall near us, they have the line coming off the side to indicate where you're supposed to put the bigger prong, I guess it is. And it's much harder to see emotion in that face because it's not symmetrical like a normal human face. It has this big, you know, as if somebody had a tattoo off the side of one of their eyeballs. Still looks like a face, but it's less compelling. I'm sure many PhDs have been written about the perception of faces in wall switches. If not, then they should be.
Going back to school.
Yeah. So I hope this one works. This will require sound. Uh-oh, wait a minute. Oh, please load. If this doesn't load, it's okay. Here we go. Oh, God. Get the app. Here we go.
Many of us have become quick to catch illusions that trick our eyes. But
first of all, is everyone hearing that voiceover?
Yeah. Yes. Anyone?
Good. Okay. All right. Here we go.
How often do you consider illusions of the ear? Are you really able to trust your ears and the things they hear? For example, listen to Greg speaking.
Bar, 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 bar.
What do you hear? If you heard bar, 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 you'd be right. But how about now?
Bar, 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 bar.
Chances are you heard far, far, far this time with an F, except you didn't. In fact, the audio didn't even change between the two videos.
Bar, bar, bar.
Strange as it may seem, what you hear depends on which video you're looking at. Go ahead, take turns watching each video and see how the sound morphs.
Bar, bar, bar.
This is a perfect example of something called the McGurk effect, which shows how our visuals can alter what we believe we're hearing. Now I want you to count how many times you see a circle flash on screen. Let's do that one more time. Did you see it flash twice? Many people do, yet without the sound, it becomes clear that the circle is only flashing once. In this case, the sound has altered your perceived vision. The next one works best with other people around. I'll play two tones, and you tell me if they're ascending or descending. In other words, are the notes played from low to high or high to low? Listen to this. Which was it? How about this one? Write down what you heard for each number and let us know in the comments. Chances are, if you compare with enough people, you'll all have different answers. Surprising? Try some more. And this one.
So I'm going to pause. I tend to hear descending. Does anyone hear ascending? Meaning the
second time. Ascending both times.
I heard opposites.
Oh, God, I love it.
Yeah, I heard opposites. Yeah.
It sounds to me like they're chords.
Yes, they are. Yes. And yeah, apparently, you know, I'm oversimplifying, but it's essentially which frequencies we hear louder tends to dominate which chains, because I think that within each chord, within each pair of chords, there's a tone that is going lower and the tone that's going
higher. Yes.
I believe that's correct. And I think, and it may be in here, you can create a series of tones that sound as if they're constantly increasing and never stop, even though it's the same tone, same series of tones over and over and over. This may be in here, I'm not sure.
How is it possible that you're hearing something different from others? It's an auditory illusion called the tritone paradox. It's created in such a way that the tones contain both a higher and lower frequency in them, but our brains have a preference of which to listen to. Diana Deutsch, the creator of this illusion, found that your geography and language from infancy all play a role in deciding this preference. Finally, listen to this audio clip of a gradually climbing tune.
I thought it was in here.
And yet, if I play the exact same clip back to you, it will sound like it's only continuing to climb higher and higher. I swear this is the exact same clip I just played. You can rewind that section of this video over and over and check for yourself. Try it. Each time you start it over, the tune is seemingly climbing even higher. It's
What he means by that is where he had stopped before, he picked up again. And even though it sounds as if, whoa, you started way back at the beginning, low. You know what I mean? It's like he played a series. It sounds like it's climbing. Then he played it again. We went back to the beginning of it, which is why this can sound as if it's just
called the shepherd tone illusion, of which there are many variations. In it, multiple sine waves are played on top of one another, raising in pitch, while one quickly drops down an octave as the others continue rising. But our brain doesn't notice this drop, and so the clips sound like they're rising forever. These illusions may help to explain how something like music can have such a profound yet varying effect on our minds, which we discuss in our new ASAP Thought episode here, along with the question of whether or not music can save your life. There's a link in the description.
Okay, I'll pause there. We're not going to get into whether music can save your life. Clearly, it can. Let me see here. We all absolutely trust our memories and know that they're perfect. That's not true, but we certainly shocking events. Like, you may recognize this, the Challenger disaster. You know, it was a, I remember, watching that live, and it was, I don't know if everybody else here remembers where they were, what they were doing, who they were with. But there's a, I think there's a widely held belief that shocking events, so-called flashbulb memory, is much more reliable than ordinary memory. That when something intense happens, what we remember, what we perceive and recall of that event is highly accurate. So space disaster happened in 1986, dating myself. The very next day, very forward-thinking psychologists at Emory University in Atlanta had 106 students write down the following: where they were, who they were with, blah, 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 when they first heard the news or saw the news. Had them write it down. Okay, so this is recorded and presumably quite accurate the next day. They then went back 2.5 years later. This is quite an amazing study. Found 44 of those students and had them repeat that exercise. And of course, they were all perfectly confident in what they recalled, except that the average correspondence was very poor, meaning 3 out of 7 categories of, when, where, what time of day, who they were with, what medium. 3 out of 7 on average. Interestingly, 25% had no correspondence. And their confidence had no correlation with accuracy. 75% did not recall filling out the original questionnaire. Now, these are college students, someone once pointed out, and I go, okay, all right. But still, that's pretty amazing that you got participated in a study, the day after that event, and you don't remember filling that thing out. I mean, that's pretty impressive, I think. A pretty impressive demonstration of how fallible is our memory. This is the best thing. Even when shown the original report, some claimed that their later version was correct. Meaning, I know that's what I wrote down the day after it, but that's wrong. What I remember now is correct. And so basically, this is the illusion of confidence. I'm sorry. And that's kind of the point of talking about this in this setting. Illusions demonstrate that what we call reality is just a construct of our fallible nervous systems. Of course, they're not perfect, but they can more than be imperfect. They can actually deceive us. And I think visual illusions, as I said earlier, illustrate, no pun intended, clearly, pun intended, our reality can differ from objective reality, and that especially context matters. The colors around it, whether it's central or focal vision, what country you grew up in, this sort of thing. And I guess, again, sort of not to hammer it home, but even what seems clear and logical to us might be wrong and should be open to being questioned. Anything. I mean, that's actually what good science is saying, it's mostly empty space, but why won't my finger go through the table? Well, there's something I don't know.
Eric.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry. And I just wanted to say one more thing. Yeah. So here's, I think, a good and topical example of how logic, even current science, or at the time, might be wrong. So giving a pathogen to protect against a pathogen seems absurd. And yet that's exactly what vaccines are. And there's no logic beforehand until you learn about the immune system.
Well, the very original vaccines were more consistent with just, we're going to give you smallpox, but you'll get it through your skin. So it'll be a milder variant or milder case than if you inhaled it. So right. that was more of an inoculation than a vaccine. The vaccines we're getting now they're not full blown COVID.
Absolutely agree. Yeah, I should say that. Inoculation versus vaccination. I mean, there are some differences.
I recall with smallpox, didn't they find that people had gotten cowpox, whatever that might have been, didn't tend to get smallpox, and that was part of the reason they originally.
Right.
Started to invest this.
And that was a case of having data that was just seemed not to fit with current knowledge or with reasonable medical practice. And yet there are the data. Milkmaids tended to not get smallpox because they would get infected with the cowpox.
I actually think, I don't know that they should be grouped together, the summary. I think they're very different things. Let me just finish the point. So the first two is, I think, in neuroscience, what we call are innate desire to fill the gap. So whether it's auditory, smell, taste, or vision, when we're in the low or mid information environment, and when we see gap, our brain hates gaps, and it would do everything possible to involuntarily fill in all the gaps with whatever information we already have. And that's involuntary. It doesn't really matter how smart we are or how much education we have. Everybody's gonna be doing that unless there's a defect in our brains, right? Where the third one, that's really the difference between you have a series that's you can induce it through rationality or logic versus empirical falsification, right? Which is a scientific method. And that's a little different because those two things are voluntary and you just have to perform both to see if they get you to the same results. But at least you have some control over that, right? So you have both ways that are available to you if you want to take them. Where the first two, you have no choice. You're kind of screwed, right? Because your brain is doing this without your permission. Right, it's just doing this subconsciously. So I think those two should be separate.
Oh, I that's an excellent comment. Thank you. I guess the reason I put them together, and I completely agree with your point. You're right. One can correct one's knowledge and change one's view of something or desire for something or willingness to get vaccinated or whatever. Whereas the other are, as you said, involuntary. I guess my point is I look at the first two or the whole concept of visual illusions as an invitation to being willing to question what's in your head. Because visual illusions are undeniable, are hardwired, we tend to all see them or we can all see some of them. And that opens the door to, maybe everything I think I'm so certain about, maybe that's not exactly reality. That's very different from being misinformed or having bad logic. But in a way, they both are about filling in gaps. In one case, I don't want to get that. I don't want you to give me cowpox. That's a disease. That's bad. That's making the leap from that thing that can make cows sick will make me sick, and therefore that's bad. Versus then adding in more information to fill in the gap with data as opposed to a supposition. I don't know if that makes sense to you, but thank you for that point, for that comment. That you're right, those are different types of fallacies or one is not exactly an illusion other than the illusion of confidence and ignorance, I guess. But thank you for that. Was there more in the chat that I'm missing? A wasted dryer. I just saw that guy. I love that. Okay. So thank you all for tuning in. This website there is where I got, the one with the square, the green blobs moving and the pink dots and so on. And there are many, many, many more. The guy has done a great job of collecting a bunch of different illusions. And I'm open to any questions, corrections, especially. And with that, I'll stop 5 minutes early, but of course I have a million more slides if there's time. Thank you.
Eric, do you have one on the Ames window?
On the what?
Ames window.
I don't know the Ames window.
It's one of my favorite illusions and it's even when you have something there to try to figure out what it is you're looking at, it's like a trapezoid window. You can pull up the link. And wow, what happens is the window, it looks like it's a trapezoid.
Uh-huh.
And he's actually going to put this in here. So when you have those rooms where it's based on forced perspective, where one person.
You mean that physical room that you. That
the one physical room, but there's actually an illusion with the window.
Yes, yes.
If you spin the window, it looks like it's oscillating.
Right.
But it's actually spinning around. And this guy built a giant big Ames window and stuck himself in the middle of it. And as it was turning, it looked like the window was going through his body.
Oh, cool. I'm right now.
Even though he put stuff attached to it, to get, and even when you thought you knew that it was spinning around, it still looked like it was oscillating, but then this object was doing something funky. And it's I found out about it this week. It's like really interesting.
Cool. Oh, here, Jeff, I noticed something in the office that where Jeff is hosting us. It's a picture here. I'll turn my
sharing. Camera. You don't have to stop your sharing.
Okay. You go right ahead here. Take control. Now what?
All right. So you'll have to focus, Eric.
Are you putting it in front of my face? Yeah. Oh, there you go. On top left. Yeah. So looking at this is in the bathroom here. And I walked in, and at first I thought, oh, hexagon. Oh, wait, it's a pentagram. Wait, it's a hexagon. Wait, it's a pentagram. Very interesting little drawing.
This is totally organic.
Yeah. I literally saw this right before the talk. They're everywhere. They're everywhere. They're after us.
Eric, are there any illusions on smell or taste?
Yes, there are some interesting ones, and I can't think of any, but there are some smells. If you tell someone, you know, this is a cow turd or whatever, and yet it's actually a tomato. I'm totally, and they smell one thing. And then you tell them what it actually is, and then they can smell that.
I don't have a smell generator on my laptop, so I, you know, we can get the.
Oh no, that's okay.
There's one on like American. I don't remember. It's either like American Test Kitchen, or another a food show. They actually run a test to see if they blindfold you, and then also cover up your nose. If you'll be able to distinguish between like any kind of food, actually. Right. And then also if they deprive you of certain sensory, you know, and just let you smell, and you also have trouble with certain type of food. So yeah.
Yeah, humans actually have horrible, horrible senses of smell compared to like dogs and cats. Cause so much of my understanding is that the parts of our brain that used to would smell things got taken over by our language processing centers.
Yeah, I don't know exactly how much was a battle versus just stuff not being preserved because it didn't offer much evolutionary advantage, you know, or it could be a resource thing, as you said. You know, clearly our ability to read faces and see three-dimensionally and see certain colors is proved advantageous. Whereas smell is not so important. Yeah, we have a couple dogs. We have a dachshund in particular. Oh my God, that guy can smell anything. If I, you know, let's just say I was cooking 3 hours earlier and washed my hands twice, still he'll go to, you know, right to that hand, you know, not the one with the knife, the other hand that was holding the thing. There was another comment I was gonna make in response to something someone said. Let me just show you one more illusion. These are kind of fun. This is another color context illusion. So I'm sure everyone can clearly see that there's some kind of aqua bars on the left and some green bars on the right. And so, I mean, I need you to be able to see those that I'm talking about. Okay. You know what's coming. Okay. They still look different. Aqua and green. Yeah. Still. How about now? I love this. Merely the color they're next to, you know, changes. Obviously, that it's amazing. I mean, really, when I do this presentation for the next, you know, week or two, I'm going to be questioning every color I see. we talked about shepherd's tones already. Oh, let me skip all that. Sorry. Yeah, this is sort of a related comment. You know, supposedly Albert Einstein said that common sense is actually nothing more than the positive prejudices laid down in the mind prior to the age of 18. And you know, this is not really about an illusion so much as a predisposition to see and hear what we want, which can be both positive and negative. You know, one can find a fence if we're looking for it, or you can find beauty if you're looking, if that's what you want to see. Anyway. I have one more thing. Hold it. So this is another one of those how we compensate. And I put this up just because it's from my life. So this is a couple of years ago. This is handsome looking guy over here. This is me. Handsome looking, not actually handsome. And these are my boys. And you can clearly see that his jacket is darker than snow, right? It's darker than the shadow, except that put him side by side. There's the edge of the jacket, there's the snow. You know, now again, it's because of the shadow. You know, we know that that's white snow. It just doesn't look that dark. Not the best example. I like the other one better. Another color one. This is another AB thing. You know, which one looks darker, which one looks more brown? You know what's coming. I'm gonna put up a bunch of masks, same color. Even though they're not, I mean, they look different even with the same color. Oh, and why don't I just stop that? I'm actually really wanting to hear what if any of these people didn't see, you know, like you mentioned, Jeff. Tactile illusions, there's some wonderful, a fake hand illusion, and I don't have a video of it. And maybe you've heard of this, where you have someone put their hand under, and like inside a little like tunnel, yeah, dead hand, that has another hand, like a fake hand on top of it. And you know, while stroking the fake hand, you're also stroking their hand. And pretty soon, the fake hand starts to feel like part of their body, even though they can see that it's not part of their body. And the real kicker of that is I've seen this thing done where once the person really feels that it's part of their body, they stab it. And of course, the people jump back and shriek and are freaked out, even though it's not their real hand, you know? Because it had
I'm sorry, possible. I have to ask, like, what was the premise for why are we doing this?
Like, why are we talking about illusions?
Like, why did the experimental setup here? I'm going, like, what was the motive for convincing someone that their hand was?
I can give you one example of its use.
Let me answer her question.
Yeah, yeah. So okay. I put it in the chat.
It was just an example.
They were doing the research because like people who lose, especially in yes. wars, when they lose like hands or limbs, they still get the the desire to scratch, and it's painful, mm-hmm. and but they obviously can't scratch it because it's not there anymore.
That's actually not strictly correct. The like phantom limb problem for people who lose it is a real neurological issue that the nerves are in fact sending scratch signals or pain signals.
Well, no, I understand. Yes. But what I'm saying is that there's no actual limb to scratch, right?
Right.
Because the limb is gone. Right. And then I think this neuroscientist called Raman Chandran, he designed this tool called the mirror box.
Right.
Where by looking at this thing side by side, you can actually train your neural system to distinguish the actual limb versus the phantom limb.
And that also can help to reduce the painful sensations. Yeah, the thing I was talking about with the rubber hand was just a way of demonstrating that one can even have an illusion about what's part of one's body, mm-hmm. you know, beyond losing a limb, you know, just a normal.
Okay, now I'm seeing like the purpose.
Sorry about that. Yeah.
I was like, what?
Yeah, why would you do that? Well, humans, what are you gonna do?
Yeah.
Not scientists, you know. was there something else? I hope I didn't cut anyone off.
Oh, I had the same answer. So
well, good. It's good to have backup. Thank you. I can look through and see what's next. I'm not sure. Oh, here we go. Sure looks if it's moving. Especially like if I look like from outer to inner, it tends to move. But peripherally,
that one and the other one that looks like it's moving. Both of those, like I don't like it makes me physically uncomfortable to look at, like motion sick almost.
Sure. Yeah. And isn't that interesting? That even though there's no motion, because you perceive motion, you get what you would normally get with motion. Yeah, that's First of all, I'm sorry to hear that. I can't be very comfortable. So I can change slides. I have no idea what's next. God. Oh, so this one, just get a blank piece of paper or a white wall or something, a whiteboard, and just stare at this dot right in the middle for like 15 seconds. So we can all do it together very meditatively. Just stare at that dot. And then what I'm going to ask you to do is then very quickly shift your gaze to a blank wall. Now, what do you see? Yeah. I don't know about all of you, but I, and Jeff, I assume also saw a normal colored American flag, you know, because we sort of saturated the receptors for the complement of the colors of the American flag. Or not the receptors, the circuitry. I'm really scared to keep clicking, but let's just see what's next. another good illusion. I don't have this link, but it's a black and white picture that when spinning, how you look at it seems to take on color, a brown color. So it's like, again, a mixture of movement becoming color. It's kind of like the click and the circle disappearing, how our senses can combine together to create illusions to misrepresent the world. Let's see. This is not a really good one, but because I realize in the digital age, this one doesn't work so well, but you know, it's a matter of resolution. One can argue with pixels, but it also works with in the real world if you have that sign. Oh, sorry, never mind. How do you see color? Forget it. There we go. I'm done. But I will definitely look for the Ames window. Thank you for that.
Eric, I don't know if you know of these books that you would like, it look like random stuff. But like some people would say that if you saw them like in a certain way, like you would see like a 3D image.
Mm-hmm.
Magic eye books.
Is that related to all of this, or is that an entirely separate phenomenon?
Well, I guess if in your mind is the percept of something that is not objective reality, then that's an illusion. You know, me seeing a piece of paper blowing across the lawn when there's nothing there is an illusion. Or my, as somebody mentioned, I guess, you know, priming, you know, you can prime people to see stuff that's not there. Like, you know, kids, I think, see ghosts on Halloween, you know, because they expect to and they're looking for it. And so those are illusions. I think there are probably lots and lots of examples of Bigfoot, I'm guessing, is another example of, at least I assume, I don't know, the truth is out there, right? I'm assuming that there is no actual Yeti or Bigfoot, and yet people quote unquote see it because something fit their expectation, or maybe they really, really wanted to see it and something fit just enough to be interpreted that way. Does that answer your question?
It reminds me of when I was reading a book about flying saucers, and there was a case where a woman was walking at night and she saw a jet airliner, but it was entirely silent. And it was, you know, and it was quite close to her, and, you know, and she was totally freaked out. And it turned out that there was a meteor shower where a bunch of little dots were in a row. And of course, they were 1,000 miles away, but she was thinking it was nearby, and her mind built this airplane hull around these dots, and said she was sure she saw windows of an airplane. She was watching an airplane. You know?
Right. White triangle. Or ancient Greeks smoking or drinking God knows what and seeing swans and half horse, half fish in the sky. You know, formations of stars that looked like that. That's a little different. They were obviously just trying to make sense of what patterns they saw. And again, I mean, and of course, the point of this is not just to say, yeah, we can be fooled, but what's the antidote? What's the what's the other side of this is be willing to question something and try to find a way to get an objective, unbiased, reproducible, whatever answer. You know, for like, for example, with all these illusions, you can put your finger on it, or you can cover part of it, or, you know, this sort of thing. I think that's it's hard to question what we want to believe, but that is still very important. Preaching to the choir, I know.
That's what we do. Any general Q&A?
It is important to remember that if you see something that can be explained two ways, like I was outside and saw this bright light in the sky just after sundown and thought I was seeing a supernova, mm-hmm. and started looking to prove that there was a supernova up there, and of course there wasn't a supernova up there. This is just, I'm just somebody who doesn't know much about the sky, and that was Venus.
Wow. Wow.
But it could be a supernova, but it's much more likely to be Venus.
You know, I love that you're ruling out, coming up with alternative explanations and ruling them out is, I guess, is really what we're talking about. Yes. And, you know, this happens all the time in our real lives, you know, like some, I don't know, like on my farm or something, you know. Earlier, there was something that belongs in one of our pastures that kept disappearing from that pasture, and, you know, with the horses, and it's like, you know, they couldn't possibly pick it up and move it, blah, blah, blah. But it turned out that if it was dropped in a certain area, our donkey and another pasture could pick it up and move it. It wasn't aliens, it wasn't wind, it wasn't that we'd left the gate, that I'd left the gate open accidentally, it was the donkey, you know.
Yes.
I mean, there's all kinds of, I'm sure that everybody here could come up with a good example of how,
yeah.
there was something, they had an explanation, they were puzzled, came up with an alternative explanation, and found a way to decide between those two. That's, you know, we do that very easily when it's nothing involving our ego or our you know, place, person, position of power or something like that. But yeah, it's, and I wish I had some examples. The same thing you had too, Bob, was something I saw, and it seemed freakishly close, and I was almost going to duck, and it was something like a meteor. I mean, that isn't it. I wish I could remember it now. But it
has anybody amazing. Ever been in a parked car, and you've got your foot on the brake, you're in
park, yes.
and then the car beside you starts backing out, and you're like, why is my car, yes. moving? It is
slammed down on the brake.
You know, I think that's called the Morel illusion. I'm not sure. It will be from now on.
Yes.
That's a great example, Beth. Thank you so much.
Yep. Yeah.
I've had that, and it's frightening.
Oh, yeah.
Wow. Yeah, that's good. I'm going to write that one down.
I think on boats, you know, it's very hard to tell whether your boat is moving or the boat next to you is, yeah. moving. That because there's so little sensation of anything.
Yep.
Yeah, particularly on a larger boat.
Very good presentation, Eric.
Oh, well, thank you. I appreciate it. And if you have any favorite visual illusions, please send them to me. You know, I like to pick the ones that I think are, you kind of make a point real clear, and the different fallibilities, you know.
Thank you.
Who's the,
you're welcome.
The duck and rabbit one, where you can
see. Oh, yeah, that's a good one.
Yeah,
that's another one of those. Yeah, duck, rabbit, or the young girl, old lady.
Face. Yes.
That's an ancient one. That's from a long time ago. Yeah, yeah, yeah. That's a good example. Yeah.
Ramiro also wanted to bring up the dress.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. Yes. And Laurel and Yanny and Green Needle, whatever that other one is.
Yeah.
Rainstorm and Green Needle.
Yeah, the famous dress. Yeah, what color is the dress? Yeah, that's a great example.
Blue and black. It will always be blue and black and
white. That's another shadow-caused illusion.
Right, exactly.
Overexposure. I know how it is, but it will be blue and black forever.
Actually, I guess I should always include that one because everyone's expecting it, right? It's like, if you don't show the dress, you're not doing it right. You're not covering everything.
I'm putting a file in the chat that somebody had annotated the famous, semi-famous rabbit duck one and added an extra thing. And then my mom couldn't see the chicken ballerina with bumhole. I don't know if y'all are. So I had to draw it in for her.
I'm sorry, wait a minute. Did you just say chicken ballerina with bum hole?
I put it in the chat. You have to look in the chat.
You've got this. Well, the duck rabbit, that's a brand of
ballerina with a bum hole.
Oh my God. Where is it?
The ears are the feet. Bunny tail.
I had to annotate it for my mom because she just couldn't see it.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I see the rabbit.
Mm-hmm. What are they?
I see the chicken.
The bunny's eyes, the butthole.
Why is the accent?
Oh, I thought that was the chicken's. I thought that was the duck's eyeball, not the chicken.
It is the duck's eyeball, but it becomes the chicken's, it becomes the ballerina butthole.
Right. I guess I don't.
The whole.
I'm going to have to work on ballerina. I see rabbit and I see duck, but I don't.
I put the annotated one so that you can see the ballerina.
This is a case of like reverse priming. I really don't want to see it.
Rotate it so chicken ballerina.
No, please don't.
At the bottom. Thank you.
There's also an illusion in the Pepsi logo.
No.
The modern day Pepsi logo. There's like an obese person's belly.
Good. Can everyone hear Jeff?
Yes.
Okay. There's an obese person's jelly in the Pepsi logo.
Belly.
It's a panis.
I'm gonna pull up Pepsi logo. Oh, sorry. A very good type of logo. This one?
Yeah, you can never unsee it once you've seen it.
Oh, that's a shirt and that's the pants and that's right. His belly.
Yeah.
I knew I never liked Pepsi for some reason.
It's like plumber's crack.
I have to go Coca-Cola.
This is the red shirt, blue pants, and that's this white belly.
Yeah, that's boring. Coca-Cola's boring. Yeah, I see no bellies there. Oh, this could be a mouth. True. Of a cracked head. I got nothing. I got nothing.
Those are eyes.
Oh, that's true. Oh, and smarmy face. Oh, I don't like Coke anymore. No, I'm kidding. Yeah, when can see faces? Wherever you want, just pretty much. Mm-hmm. And I'll have to look up and think about classic architecture. That's a wonderful point.
Shall we bring this thing in for a landing?
Yeah, I guess so. Anything else? Any other great suggestions, points, corrections? Always need those. They're painful, but I welcome them.
No, great presentation.
Thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
I haven't been regular to these lately, but when I saw this, I said, doing this on Zoom has got to be interesting.
Interesting. I hope it was interesting.
It was good. It was good. I saw essentially all of them.
Great. Good. Good. Oh, I'm glad. And I guess there's a way. Oh, I don't know if any of that stuff's copyrighted, so I probably can't just share it. I have no idea. Well, you know what?
Folks can email you.
Yeah, you can email me if somebody wants a copy. Right. Yeah.
Everybody got the email address already? Or you can message on Meetup.
Right.
There it is.
All right. All right, everybody, have a safe drive home. Don't run into any UFOs because they're real.
Yeah, that's right.
Well, good seeing everyone.
Thank you.
Actually, no, it really it is. Thank you all for participating.
Right.
Very nice. Bye. Well done. Thanks, thank you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Good night.
Thanks, Jeff. All
right. Yes, thank you.
You're welcome. Have a good night.
Huh?
That's it.
Yeah.